Shalom.
Shalom.
Hallelujah.
Welcome to all the wonderful participants of our really exciting, and I never lose the excitement again and again, meeting people who have come in the honor of the State of Israel, people from all over the world, people who are connected to the land, connected to the city of Jerusalem, connected to the people of Israel, and connected to God Himself. And it's really a blessing. And this time, in such a meaningful week.
Amen.
A meaningful week when we're celebrating the 70th Independence Day of Israel, which in itself is a miracle. State of Israel is a miracle. Almost every word I take out of my mouth is a miracle. And the fact, the number 70, with the leader of the free world recognizing Jerusalem.
Amen.
Anybody who doesn't feel a connection to the book of Ezra, chapter 1, is definitely disconnected. The miracle of millions of Christians around the world who were supporting Israel, praying for Israel. The miracle of the Schindler Society, and the fact that we have Rosalind herself, Rosemary Schindler Darlow, with us today. Really, the initiator of this event. The fact that the Knesset is open, even though we're on vacation, is also a miracle in itself. And the fact that we're here is such a great miracle, and therefore it's only expected to begin this session with the National Anthem of Israel. And I'm going to invite Chazan Rabbi Ilan Adler, who will all stand up and join Hatikva.
Years ago. And, this, when we came back here, it was literally, not just figuratively, a homecoming. And especially when I see so many people from around the world really feeling the pulse of Israel, the pulse of the Torah, the pulse of so many things the Jewish people hold valuable and hold so near and dear to our hearts. And I see people from all over the world, nations, people from the nations, who are feeling so close to to what we feel close to here in Eretz Yisrael. I spoke to several people today, first-time visitors. So that's an amazing thing. And I asked them, how's it going? And they go, wow, wow. The whole thing is a big blessing. So it's really an honor to sing the Hatikva anywhere, but to sing it here in the Knesset. My sister's here from Providence. It's a good word. Providence, Rhode Island. My dear wife, Rivka, is here, having just written a book about called Ten from the Nations, talking about this worldwide movement of people from the nations coming close. So I guess the Hebrew word is mitzamrer. Something like it sounds like a kind of a steak, but it's not. Mitzamrer means goosebumpy. Goosebumpy. So when I sing the Hatikva here at the Knesset with so many people who give us so much nachat, so much joy and pleasure, I get goosebumps. So I appreciate your asking.
Thank you, Rabbi Adler, and I'm happy that God did put those words, that question into my mouth so we get to hear your story.
Thank you. We're just going to wait for the applause to die down.
And it is a blessing. Yeah. A few months ago, I was in Singapore speaking to a group of several hundred businessmen, supporters of the Karen Yisod, and they asked me, what's the secret? How is Israel becoming a startup nation with so many high-tech companies and so many startup businesses? And what's the secret? What's the secret of Israel? And I told them that, you know, when you open a business, anybody who opens a business knows that, there are so many points that you say, okay, the heck with it. It's so difficult. It's impossible. And then you say, okay, I'll try, we'll give it one more try. And again, there are so many bureaucracies, you know, Israel, they always say it's a Jewish and a bureaucracy state. And some people use it, democracy, but it's a Jewish and bureaucracy. But when you're, there's so many reasons to give up. When you're a nation, for 2,000 years, going through so many different reasons to give up, and then you choose your national anthem to be Hatikva, hope. You just don't give up. And those of you who have, and those of us who have God in our hearts, in our lives, it's not only in businesses. Some of us got married once, living a marriage life. There's so many times you say, okay, the heck with it. And if you have God in your heart, and you have God in the house, and you have God in the family, that's the reason to go on and continue and to be part of representing God in this world. We're going to start right to the point, teaching Torah, teaching the Bible. Once again, I chose this time a chapter from the Book of Psalms. What's beautiful about Psalms is really you can connect to it. Everybody can feel where he fits in. And my mother always used to teach me that if you have the right tool, it's 90% of the fixing of the thing you're trying to do. In the Bible, when you see the structure, it's 90% of understanding the chapter. Because when we open the book, even in this beautiful Bible, which emphasizes the words of the connection to God, the connection to Israel, and so many different chapters. But when we read the verses of the Bible, verse after verse, we don't realize the beauty, the art of the structure. And therefore, we're going to learn today chapter 107 in the book of Psalms. And you have it in front of you in a chart. Once again, as I said last time, those of you who really want to understand Bible should learn the language. But we're going to try to read together this chapter. And I think it's really, we can actually see. The chapter begins with the words of thanks, because it's a psalm of thanksgiving. But it's not an expression of gratitude to God on the part of an individual speaking, in the first person recounting what happened to him. But it's a part of thanksgiving as a group. And the psalm opens with these three verses that sort of comprise the headline, heading for the entire psalm. The first three sentences. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his loving kindness is forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord say this, whom he redeemed from the hand of distress, and whom he has gathered from the lands, from east and from west, from the north and from the sea. Once again, this is also a chapter which we read, as you can understand, the beginning of the celebration of Independence Day. In our prayer book, this is how we begin. So these three verses which I just read before are like a heading for the entire psalm. They give thanks to the Lord. These are the words that will be said by the redeemed of the Lord, when he redeems them from the hand of distress. And then we come, as you can see with the page in front of you, with four stanzas. The four stanzas with a fixed structure that seem to like spell out in detail what was stated in general terms in the opening verses. Each stanza is an example of the redeemed whom God delivered from some distress, and who thank him for the loving kindness that he performed for them. The first stanza, verses 4 through 9, describe those who were lost their way in the desert, and were hungry and thirsty, God led them on the straight path to go to his city of habitation. Let's read a few sentences. Hungry and thirsty, their spirit fainted within them. Then they cried to the Lord in their distress, and he delivered them from their troubles. Stanza 2 describes those who were imprisoned in darkness and the shadow of death, and God took them out of their captivity, broke their bonds asunder. Stanza 3 describes those who were ill, devoid of all food, coming near the gates of death, and God healed them from their illness and rescued them. And stanza 4 describes those who went to the sea and a storm threatened their ship, placing them in great danger. And God silenced the storm and led them to their desired harbor. As I said before, these four stanzas have a uniform structure. Each stanza is built of four parts. The first part, of course, describes the distress. Of course, in this part, each stanza distinguishes itself from the other, as we mentioned before. The second part described how those in distress cry out to God, and how he answers these cries. This part, of course, as we see emphasized here, repeats itself almost word by word in each of the four stanzas, with only slight variations of the verbs, as you can see. Then they cried out to the Lord in their distress, and he delivered them from their troubles. We'll read that sentence in Hebrew, of course. Vayitzaku el Adonai batzar lahem mimetzukotehem yatzilem. Again and again, they cried out. The third part of each stanza, both in practical terms, how God answers their cries of those in distress, how he saves them from their troubles. And here, too, the various stanzas differ one from the other. The fourth part of each stanza describes the gratitude offered to God by those who were rescued. And this part, of course, is comprised of two verses in each stanza. The first one of them is identical. Yodu l'Adonai chasdo, let them thank the Lord for his kindness and his wondrous work to the children of men. And the second verse, of course, in addition to the previous one, is different in each stanza. In stanza 1 and 2, the additional verse contains the explanation of the gratitude, and therefore it opens with ki. Of course, the explanation in each stanza is different in accordance with the distress and the rescue described in each. Following these four stanzas, which tell of the individuals who encountered various kinds of troubles and were safe, stanza 5 and 6, which are appearing in the second page that you have in your hand there, expand the discussion to lands and to nations. Just as God brings troubles and danger to the individuals, and when the circumstances changes, he saves them from their distress, so too regarding to nations and their lands. Stanza 5 begins, as we see in verse 33, with an account of the punishment that God brings to the land. He turned rivers into wilderness, springs of word into water into dry land, ground. A fruitful land into desolation because of the wickedness of those who dwell therein. Even though it's not stated explicitly, it's clear that the inhabitants of this land, because of their wickedness, the land was turned into wilderness. They could no longer live there and were first forced into exile. The continuation of this stanza describes a reversal state. The state where he turned wilderness into a pool of water, dry ground into springs of water. He settled the hungry there, and they established a city of habitation. And they sowed fields and planted vineyards, and they yielded fruits of increase. And he blessed them, and they multiplied greatly, and he did not diminish their count. So that's stanza 5. And then stanza 6 describes a process parallel to that found in stanza 5. But this time, the process is described directly in the relationship to the nation. But they were diminished and brought low by the dominion of evil and sorrow. He pours contempt upon rogue nobles, and he makes them wander in the wilderness where there is no way. But he has set the needy on high from poverty, and he has made their families like a flock. So here again, the comparison that we see between 5 and 6 and the stanzas 1 and 4 reveal the absence of two critical stages in 5 and 6. First of all, between the stage of the punishment and the stage of the redemption, there is no expression of any prayer. As we saw in stanza 1 to 4, they cried out to the Lord in their distress. This absence does not constitute a great difficulty. In the case of the nations of the land, several generations may pass between the stage of punishment and the stage of redemption. Thus, there is no room here for the description of a prayer that is immediately answered. What about the thanks? We have to say that the title on the headline at the beginning of the thing, God, give thanks to the Lord, that is the thanks which is expressed in the end of this chapter. Now, in this entire chapter, the name of the nation is not mentioned, the name of the land is not mentioned, but it's quite obvious who it's talking about. But on the one hand, the person who wrote this psalm wants every person in the world to feel connected to this psalm. He wants everybody to feel that he who is solved from his personal distress. Every one of us has gone through times where we pray to God to help us from our distress. And at the same time, we don't forget that fourth part, thanking him for the saving us. Thanking him from picking us up from the below. And at the same time, when we look the psalm begins, let the redeemed of the Lord say this. If we look at this entire issue, the process of return to Israel, people went through each one of these things. The establishment of the state of Israel, we speak of the great miracle, but we know exactly, because when we here are arguing what the solution for the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, we remember that 80 years ago they were talking about the final solution. And we remember the issues of hunger. We remember the issues of illnesses. So this entire chapter is talking about a big process. The redemption of God of the people of Israel. And I want to tell you, last week we marked the Holocaust Day here in the Knesset. And there's a tradition here that every member of Knesset reads out names of his family. And I read out the name of my grandfather, who survived. Because in 1929, he told his family that he's leaving Lodz, Poland, and he's going to the United States of America. And his 6 siblings and his mother, father passed away a few years earlier, told him, "You're crazy. What are you going to the United States of America? There's no future there. Stay with us here in Poland. Well, here is the future." So his 6 siblings and mother remained in Poland. His name was Solomon Glitzenstein. When he came to America, the lady there working in the office told him, "Listen, in America, the Glitzenstein's not going to work. Change it to Glick." And he was there alone in New York, going through issues of poverty, looking for a job, losing a job because he refused to work in Shabbat. And he thought, who knows if he's going to have a future. The final 20 years of his life, he lived in Israel. He had 2 children, his daughter Debbie, who lives in New York today with her family, and my father. My father, we made Aliyah in 1974. We were a small family, two parents and six children. Baruch Hashem. My parents today are the proud grandparents of 46 grandchildren.
Wow.
Of 81 great-grandchildren. My parents are 85 years old, and my father decided at 85 it's time to retire from his medical work. But all of his 46 grandchildren and 81 great-grandchildren are living in Eretz Israel. When my grandfather in 1929 left Poland, he would have not have dreamt that he will live in his days to see an independent state of Israel, that he himself will live in Jerusalem the final 20 years of his life, that his son will himself have so many, such a great family. And when I say 81 great-grandchildren, it's 81 great-grandchildren so far.
Yeah.
So God, guys, we can continue and read the final two sentences of this paragraph. The upright see this and rejoice. And all this and put in these shuts now. Whoever is wise must keep these things and let them contemplate the acts of loving kindness of the Lord. And here is the most important thing. Because you know, it says, in this one of the songs of ascent, when the people of Zion return, like a dream. And we always read it as like a dream. It's really miracle. Somebody once told me a very interesting explanation. He said, sometimes I teach my class, and I'm saying such great things, and I look at my class, and they're all dreaming. Sometimes great things are happening, and we're dreaming. We take them for granted. The upright see this and rejoice. You have to look at it. You have to remember. You have to concentrate on it. And if you do that, naturally, there's nothing else you can do but rejoice and praise and thank and give gratitude to the Lord who is pulling the strings of this entire wonderful phenomena, godly phenomena, redemption phenomena. And when we see the world is beginning to recognize Jerusalem as the capital of the state of Israel. 2 years ago, it was impossible. 2 years ago. I always share the story. A night before the elections in the United States of America, the Foreign Ministry of Israel sat together with all the heads of the different departments, preparing how we're going to get along with the new establishment, with the new administration. 11 of 11 all had prepared reports how they're going to be working with President Hillary Clinton. They weren't going to take any other, there was no other option. Now, I'm not getting involved in American politics. But when we see, if I would tell you that 2 years ago that the President of the United States will move the embassy to Jerusalem, you would probably hospitalize me. First of all, there's still enough reasons to hospitalize me. But thank God you're here today in the Knesset, teaching Bible to people from all over the world. And the clock says my time is 12:05 is over. So therefore, I want to give thanks to God for the ability of teaching and the ability of being here in front of you all. And I want to invite my dear friend, Rabbi Yishai Fleischer, who's supposed to be speaking about governing from a biblical... Rabbi Tuvi Weiss on the Israel Bible. How are we going to have Rabbi Tuvi Weiss on the Israel Bible?
First of all, the first thanks, you know, at least to be here, is to our host, Rabbi Yehuda Glick, who is so gracious to me personally, and I have a lot of appreciation, and it's very much in his heart to share Torah with anybody who wants to listen, Jews, non-Jews, and Rabbi Glick, as a Chaver Knesset, has gone far beyond what any Knesset member has ever done in terms of sharing Torah with the nations of the world. And I know that so many people feel that Rabbi Glick is their best friend.
Amen.
And so on behalf of everybody who's here today and who's listening on Facebook, thank you, Rabbi Glick, for opening up the door. I'd like to thank our co-host, Rosemary Schindler-Garlow, who is sponsoring this event from the Schindler Society. Rosemary and her husband, Pastor Jim, have tremendous hearts for Israel from their home in California that reaches here in Israel. Her name, you know, precedes her as a descendant of the Schindler family. Rosemary got off a plane from Poland to come straight here to the Knesset to be with us today. And Rosemary Schindler Garlow is a righteous Gentile, just like Oscar Schindler, and is also concerned with the welfare of the United States and is bringing Bible study to the Congress, to the United Nations, and is now helping bring more Torah study, more Bible study to the Knesset as well. So thank you, Rosemary. The great staff of Israel 365, who want to thank Sivya, who is broadcasting this. So for those who are watching it on Facebook, thank you to Sivya. Mayan, who is here as well, and Stephen. Thank you, Rabbi Adler and Rivka. Thank you, Yishai. Thank you. Thank you to everybody, and a special thank you to Gideon Ariel, who's a good friend, who brought his group here. And to Pastor Mark, who also has brought his wonderful group here as well. We've been in touch for a long time, and it's so nice to not only have you, welcome you in Israel, but to the Knesset, to a Bible study, which I know is something that you do amazingly in Washington, to the entire world. So it's a really special day for me, because today is really officially the first day that we are launching this as the Israel Bible. And for those of you who are seeing it, we're really one of the first in the world to see it. We've been working on it for a very long time, but today is really the launch, the week of Yom HaAtzmaut, and I want to start sort of my remarks with a blessing. It's a special blessing that we say upon reaching a significant milestone, and that is the Shehecheyanu prayer, the Shehecheyanu blessing, and it's Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam Shehecheyanu V'Kiyamanu V'Higiyanu Lazman Hazeh.
Amen.
Amen.
So the Vice President made that bracha when he made a speech in the Knesset also.
It's something that we don't whip out too frequently, that blessing. We don't pull that out so often, but if you knew how long the Israel Bible took to develop, it's been a long time in coming. And I was a rabbi in America, and I started flipping through my Tanakh in Columbus. I had a shul in Columbus, Ohio, and I started going through the Tanakh, and I started underlining all of the references to Israel for my office in Columbus. And after page of highlighting and underlining all of the references to Israel, I picked up the phone and I called my wife and I said, Abby, what are we doing here? We gotta go. We gotta go to Israel. And that process, that exercise, which I highly encourage everybody to do, certainly Jews in America need to do this exercise. Amen. Go through it and learn the line. Go through and pay attention to all of the references to Israel. I came upon one Bible verse that says that Israel is a land like no other. It says in Deuteronomy chapter 11, verse 12, Israel is a land like no other. Israel is a land that God's eyes are on from the beginning of the year until the end of the year. And I thought, wow, you know, that's very powerful. It's the only time that I could think of that where it tells us what God does every single day. His eyes are on the land from every day, from the beginning of the year to the end of the year, from Rosh Hashanah till the end of the year, from January 1st to December 31st. And so that was the impetus for my initiative at the time, for a little project called Israel 365. Every day I was going to also send out a picture of Israel, the Bible verse that I now had a good collection of. Every day. It started by sending out an email to one person. I think my mom was the first one to sign up. After 1 month, had 1,000 people on that email list after 1 month. And I thought, like, wow, now that's it. I could retire with 1,000 people. And now, thank God, we have 300,000 people who get that email every single day. And so then I thought to myself, you know, we've already kind of...
Not 300,000 people get the email every day. 300,000 people who work get it. In essence, a juice of Israel.
Yes.
It's people who really, their life begins or ends or Israel.
Like Hashem.
Like Hashem.
Like who's awesome.
That's our mission is to be like Hashem.
Exactly. So starting Israel 365, and then I kind of thought, you know, we finished a year, we finished 2 years, and we had hundreds of Bible verses and hundreds of little lessons about Israel. And I thought, well, we're pretty much halfway done to having our own Bible already, our own Bible commentary. And so I said, well, how hard could it be to make a Bible commentary out of all of these lessons? We're already, you know, I assumed we were already done at that point. And that was 4 years ago. And then we started collecting these things and realized, wow, this is a big project. This is a big project. And we went out to a book publisher, and they all wanted this book, I'm telling you. They're with every book publisher in Israel, in Jerusalem. They all wanted to work on this project. And we worked with a company called Koren, and it's the prestigious Bible publishing company that produced this one. This is the official Bible of Israel that Knesset members get sworn on, right? IDF members get sworn in on that Bible. And they were very excited about that project. And we signed a contract 2 years ago. They thought that we'll be able to, we're experts in Bible, we can have this done in a couple of months. And that was 2 years ago. We got very excited because we were going to release this in 2016. And that was a special year. And then it kind of dragged on, and we had to edit it and re-edit it and re-edit it. And then we lost a lot of time, but we said, you know what? It's the 50th year. In 2017, it was the 50th year of Jerusalem. That's going to be, it must be a wonderful time. It's meant to be that we're supposed to release the Israel Bible in the year of the 50th anniversary of Jerusalem. But then we realized that we still have what to do. We want to put maps in the Israel Bible. And then we opened, and then I spoke to one of my mentors, and he said, you know what, Tuli, the world has waited 3,000 years for the Israel Bible. We can wait another year. And so we said, we want more to do, and more comments, and more commentary. And now, here we are. We are the week of Israeli Independence Day, the 70th year of Yom HaSu'ud, of Israeli Independence Day. Going to excuse the group from Pastor Mark's group from Washington. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Lucky that you're doing every single year, a special year.
Yes, more
so. You can all join the table. One thing, one of the advantages of a round table is everybody, wherever he's sitting, is at the head of the table. So join those diverse that are here with us.
Let me just share with you a quick idea on the significance of the number 70. What is the significance of the number 70? Okay? The significance of the number 70 is that it appears in the Torah as sort of bookends. It appears at the beginning of Genesis, and it appears again at the end of Deuteronomy. Noah, in chapter 10 of Genesis, has exactly 70 descendants. Okay? And they're all listed, and that becomes the basis for, in Judaism, the number 70 represents the nations of the world. Okay? And then later on in Deuteronomy, in chapter 27 of Deuteronomy, as Moses is prepared to lead the people of Israel into the land, God tells Moses to do something very interesting. He says to inscribe these words, the Katacha Avanim of Kol Divrei Torah Zot, the Er Heitev. The Er Heitev. What does Rashi say the Er Heitev means? To translate the Torah into 70 languages. When Moses led the people of Israel, when Joshua led the people of Israel into the land of Israel, he translated the Torah into 70 languages. That's what we believe, the Jewish people believe, because the Torah is not just meant for the Jewish people. 70 represents our obligation to teach the Torah to the entire world. So I think that God really wanted us to release the Israel Bible for the 70th year, because 70 is the year of the nations of the world.
By the way, towards the end of Deuteronomy, in Deuteronomy 32, verse 8, it says that, when the Most High gave nations their homes and set divisions of man, he fixed the boundaries of the people in relation to the Israel's numbers. So the 70 nations and the people of Israel are exactly that 70, representing the connection between the elderly of Israel, or 70 leaders of Israel, compared to the 70 nations, and that was the comparison of those two numbers, and that's what that means.
So there's many, many special features of the Israel Bible. We talk on every page about the role of the land of Israel, the people of Israel, the God of Israel, on every page and in every chapter of the Israel Bible. And we talk about the well-known miracles of the gathering of the exiles that, you know, Rabbi Adler spoke about, and Judah spoke about, his family coming back on the wings of eagles to the land of Israel. We talk all about the magic, the miracles, the wonders of the land coming to life again. And we talk about that throughout the Israel Bible. But we also focus on the lesser known miracles, the miracle that the non-Jewish nations, the 70 nations, are going to now partner with the Jewish people, help us as we reconnect to our ancestral homeland, and that special relationship that God wants between the Jews and the nations of the world, whether they're in California, or in Washington, or in China, or in Hong Kong, or in South Korea. We have friends from all over the world here today. From Texas, right? God has a plan for each and every one of us, whether you're Jewish or whether you're not Jewish, to help about bring about the restoration of Israel. And I believe and I hope and I pray that this is the year, the 70th year, the year of the nations, the year of the Israel Bible, that God will allow us to do that.
Amen.
Now, I know that I've gone over my time, but yeah. I want to just take a minute, because the Israel Bible would not be possible without a few very, very special people who are here today, okay? And I'm so happy that now we have even a more intimate crowd to be able to have an intimate moment and to really be able to thank from the bottom of my heart a few very special people who are here today. The first thank you goes to Helena Igra and Mark Singer. Mark and Helena have opened up their hearts and have opened up their home to me when we were talking about this in Miami, Florida, years ago. We were talking about this idea. They came back from a Kufi conference. Mark was active with Zion Oil, and he was at a Kufi conference, and he said that this is an incredible blessing for the Jewish people. We have to figure out how to tap into this and how to connect Christians with Israel in a meaningful way. And Mark and I, we started working together. That was already more than 6 years ago, 7 years ago, 8 years ago. We started kind of planning together, planting the seeds of Israel 365, an organization, a nonprofit called Teach for Israel, that is meant to bring about you to continue doing all of the good works and all of the organizations that you're connected with. So thank you very, very much. I'd also like to thank Donna Delaney, who's here as well. Donna was one of those early readers of Israel 365 who kind of, we were sending out our email probably at the time to 50,000 people, 60,000 people, and Donna would keep writing to us, and every time we would put a cause out there, she was the first to get behind that cause, to dedicate, to donate to whether it was a soup kitchen in Jerusalem, or the planting trees, or helping take care of the IDF. We were like, who is this woman? And we saw, that we were able to track her down in Hawaii. And we did a conference call at the time, and started, sharing. Donna was sharing her heart. She was talking about the blood moons, because she was sharing with me Pastor Mark's teachings about the blood moons. And I didn't know what she was talking about. I went with her, and I came with her, and the truth of the matter is that the blood moon was also a turning point in sort of helping put Israel 365 and breaking Israel news on the map. And since then, now Donna works for Israel 365. We got her an expert work visa. She works at Israel 365. It's an entirely Jewish staff, except for Donna is our representative of the 70 nations of the world. So when we want to run something by her, I'm like, Donna, how do 2 billion people think about this? She's able to give us penetrating insights, and her support and her enthusiasm, her encouragement for the Israel Bible has been so important to me personally. So thank you for everything that you have done. I'm so proud to be able to put your name into the Israel Bible. It's also really special to have with me today, to have with all of us today. The Israel Bible, I could only take credit for being able to put together a fantastic team. This was a lot of work by a lot of people. And one of the first people that I reached out to put together the Israel Bible was my old college roommate. We were in yeshiva together, and rabbinical school together, and college together, and that's Rabbi Noam Shapiro. He was the first one I called. Right? And I said, Noam, I did Genesis, but I can't do any more than this. I need help. And so Noam said that he would take one of the books. And Noam wrote the commentary for the book of Lamentations, the book of Eitha, which which is a very, very challenging book to talk about the destruction that the Jewish people would undergo, that Jeremiah prophesied about. And Noam wrote that, a very uplifting commentary on the book of Echa and the book of Lamentations that connects the Holocaust and Israel and this idea of being a people that would rise up from the grave and one day come back to our land. And so Noam is one of the wonderful scholars and rabbis who worked on the Israel Bible, and you can see a list of all of them are mentioned, and there's a lot of people who are involved who each had a very special perspective, a unique angle. And so I just encourage everybody to check out our website, theisraelbible.com, or if you can go to our website, you can purchase a copy of the Israel Bible. It's brand new. We just got them off the printer. And it's really such a special time to be able to share. So I really thank you for opening up this occasion for us, Rabbi Glick and Rosemary, to be able to launch to the world today, the week of Yom HaAtzmaut, the 70th anniversary of Israel, the Israel Bible. Thank you.
Amen.
Good advantage of the fact that the Knesset is in vacation, because when the Knesset's not in vacation, it's pretty much illegal to promote any business here. I'm very happy that the Knesset's on vacation and nobody knows what we're doing here. But also, we're like Jews, we're always like off schedule, like we're like 2,000 years off schedule. But this time we're only like 10, 15 minutes off schedule, but we're very happy to transfer. And first of all, thank you for you and for your entire team of Israel 365, who are doing wonderful work. And you know, my Rabbi Steinsaltz used to tell me the best commentator on the Bible is the Concordantia, which is like the Bible itself. And when you're just like underlining the words about Israel, that in itself already is the best commentary. The best commentary on the Bible is the Bible itself. When you compare the words which appear in different places, and they're really ringing your bell. Rabbi Yishai Fleischer, our next speaker, who, everything I say about him is not enough, but he's representing the beginning of the Kingdom of Israel, Hebron, where it all began. King David started his journey there, where he established the Kingdom of the people of Israel, and then united it and moved it to Jerusalem. And Rabbi Fleischer has the opportunity of being the spokesman for Hebron, and we're waiting to hear. In fact, he got closer to where David was born. He was closer to Bethlehem in Ephrat, and he's like on his way to Jerusalem.
Thank you very much. Thank you, everybody. I am very rarely in life overwhelmed.
Before she walks out.
Yeah.
Thank you very much, Sophia. I really deserve the privilege.
Very rarely in life am I overwhelmed. It's just not my thing. Again, to be overwhelmed. And just coming into Yerushalayim today with all the flags, and then coming into this room at the Knesset, and then being with Rabbi Glick, who is a walking miracle on many levels, and then looking at these three signs behind me, this incredible caucus for the study of the Tanakh at the Knesset, this new Israel Bible that Rabbi Tilly very movingly spoke about just now, and the Schindler Society, and having Rosemary with us here today. It's just, all together, it's just a kind of a microwave of energy, and it's all happening at the same time, at the same moment, in the same place, and it's awesome to be here with you, so thank you very much. Very rarely my wow by this, but it is a great honor to be at the Knesset today, and they asked me to talk about Jim. Pastor Jim kind of sent the message saying, you know, can Yishai talk about governance? Can we talk about governance? And I thought it through for a little bit, and I decided to talk about governance from the point of view of leadership. Leadership, biblical leadership. What does the Bible tell us about leadership? And the first great leader of the nation is Moses. He's the one. He's number one, right? And you take all the major cues for what is Jewish leadership from Moses. But you know, when he comes out from the Pharaoh's palace, he looks to see if his brothers are doing well. He sees that Jews are dying and being killed in slavery. He fights for one of them. He rescues a Jew from the hand of an Egyptian taskmaster, kills him. Next day he sees the Jews are fighting, tries to break up between them. They accuse him of favoritism or of being judgmental, right? You're being intolerant. or some language like that, and you're not into social justice or something, and suddenly he's on the run, and he goes away to Midian. He goes away to Midian, finds a new life in Midian, and he finds peace. He goes out to Montana, you know? He goes, he finds kind of a peace of mind. But God sees the characteristic traits of Moses, and he says, that's the man for me. I need him. I need Moses. Remember the song, you know, go down, Moses, way down to Egypt's land, right? Go down. I need you to go down. And they have a discussion. Now, the Bible is generally, this is an important term, it's laconic. It uses few words to describe a lot of things. It doesn't spill a lot of ink. Purpose. It wants you to dig deep into the text. But sometimes when there's a lot of text, that's there to show you, you know, look into this. Why is the Torah telling you so much information? And there's a long discourse, an argument, if you will, between God and Moses about should he go down to Egypt. And Moses doesn't want to go down to Egypt. He has too much humility. He doesn't want to go down to Egypt. God says, I need you down there. Now, our sages tell us that this was a discussion of 7 days. Arguing with God for 7 days. Think about that. You gotta be Jewish to do that, okay? It's just like, you know, God says, go down, do this. You're like, yes, sir. No, Moses is not like that, right? He's arguing with him. And he says to him, listen, I'm heavy of mouth and heavy of speech. Send somebody else. God says to him, who do you think gives mouth to a man? Who makes somebody a good talker or dumb? It's me. I'm the boss. I do that. I make mankind. I know who you are. I know who the other candidates are. I need you, Moses. Right? I'll be with your mouth. He says, I will be with you and I'll be with your mouth. And I'll tell you what to say. Moses says, can you send somebody else, please? That's what he says at the end. And then it says a very important verse. It says, God got angry at Moses. And he says to him, but I know that Aaron could be your diplomat. Go out and meet Aaron. He'll help you. You'll be the prophet. He'll be the diplomat. He'll deal with the nations. He'll deal with Pharaoh. He'll deal with the people of Israel. Don't worry. I'm sending Aaron for you. Okay. Now, this little anger that God says is angry, there are 10 times in the Torah, speaking of the Concordance here, there are 10 times in the Torah that God flares up in anger. That's what it means. It means flare up. That's what it means. His nostrils flared anthropomorphically, right? 10 times. Every time there is a flare up like this, you also see an immediate punishment. A fire will start in the camp. Something was going to happen. Somebody's going to get punished because you've made God angry. That, and God is a kind God, right? His mercy and justice is forever, but now you've really made him angry. But in this case, there is no apparent anger. There's no apparent punishment.
To be a leader is a punishment.
To be a leader is a punishment. Very good. Very good. That's a Gemara, you know? You thought I was giving you a prize. I'm giving you a punishment. Okay. But if you look at the famous commentator Rashi, he quotes the Talmud, and it says that Rabbi Yehoshua ben Karcha says, every one of the angers of God has a manifestation. This one, there's no manifestation. Where did it go? Okay. Just a few verses later, something, maybe one of the most skipped over parts of the Bible, nobody wants to touch it. Nobody wants to touch these next few verses. Moses on the way down to Egypt. Okay, he took the job. I'll do it. Okay. He takes his wife. He takes his kids. They're heading down, and they're on the way down to Egypt, and they have to stop for the night. And it says, I'll read to you in English first. It was on the way, in the lodging, that Hashem, God, encountered him and sought to kill him. What? Say what? God wanted to kill who? Moses? I thought you just sent him down to Egypt. This is why a lot of people want to deal with this, right? So, Zephra, Tzipora, took a sharp stone and cut off the foreskin of her son and touched it to his feet. And she said, you caused my bridegroom's bloodshed. So he released him, and she said bridegroom's bloodshed was because of the circumcision. Okay, a lot of very mysterious business here, right? All right, but so basically Moses was about to be killed, but somehow she circumcised the son, so maybe this angel of death was after the son of Moses. What is going on? So let's read a few verses beforehand. God says to Moses, when you go down to Egypt, see all the wonders that I've put in your hand and perform them before Pharaoh, but I shall strengthen his heart and he will not send the people. You shall say to him, so says Hashem. You shall say to Pharaoh, so says Hashem, my firstborn son is Israel. Right? That's what I want you to tell him. My firstborn is Israel. You're not releasing him, and therefore, so I say to you, send out my son that he may serve me. But you have refused to send him out. Therefore, behold, I shall kill your firstborn son. So whose son is going to be killed?
Pharaoh.
And does that happen? Yes. Yes, his firstborn son is killed. Yes, it happens. So you're not releasing my firstborn son, Israel. You, Pharaoh, are not releasing Israel. Here you go. You got it right back. It's karma. It's eye for an eye. You get justice in this world. You don't release my firstborn son, you're going to lose your firstborn son. But let's read it in the Hebrew. You say to Pharaoh, Ko amar Hashem, bnei bechor Yisrael. So say to Pharaoh, my firstborn son is Israel. Ve'omar elecha, and I said to you, who's to you? On the straight translation, it means you say to Pharaoh what I'm about to say to you, but there's another way to read it. Ve'omar elecha, and I told you, Moses, Shlach et bini, send my children, go down to Egypt, ve'avduni, and they shall serve me. V'tema'en l'shalcho, but you refuse to go down and send them. You refuse to bring my children out of Egypt. I now kill your firstborn son because you didn't feel the pain of the Jewish people when they were in slavery. You walked out there, you went to Montana, to Midian. You went to chill. You didn't want to deal with the politics. It was too messy for you. You didn't want to deal with the Jews. They were too stubborn. So you went on vacation. You were out of there. You didn't want to deal with the dirty stuff. Now I got to tell you something. You argued with me for 7 days. You got me angry because my children are in pain. You got to feel the pain of your children. You got to feel the pain of your children. You see them suffering, you got to do something about that. I'm moved right now just for a second to think about Oscar Schindler, who saw the pain of others. It wasn't his pain, but he felt the pain on himself, and he did something about that. Moses, you're going to get a punishment because you've got to feel in your own flesh the pain of a loss of a child. Like I feel, God says, like I feel the loss of my children. By the way, in Jewish law, you're not supposed to pray for Yom Kippur to be the leader of the prayer unless you yourself have children. Right? If you don't have children, you don't know what to pray for. You don't see the responsibility and the pain, what it is to be a parent or to be a ruler. So about governance, if you don't feel the pain of the people. By the way, 8 out of 9 European leaders today don't have children. How can Angela Merkel lead a country when she herself doesn't have a stake in its future? Right? It's a problem. But that's what, here's a great rabbi and a great leader before us, Rabbi Yehuda Glick. You got to go down to the people. You got to feel them. That's what governance, that's what Jewish governance is about. You got to know what's going on down at every level of society. Let's go to just one last thing. Let's skip all the way now after years of Moses being a leader. Let's now go to the book of Numbers, chapter 11, verse 16. Maybe 14. The Jewish people ask for meat. We gotta eat meat. We're tired of this totally miraculous amount of bread. Okay? Bread from the heaven? It's come on. We want some, you know. We want some McDavid's. Remember the old McDavid's restaurant? We want some nice earthly flesh. Okay? And that's it. That breaks Moses. He's been carrying, literally, he says in verse 14, he says, I cannot alone carry this nation. It's heavier than me. I'm unable to carry it alone. And if this is what you're going to do to me, God, by making me carry these people alone, why don't you just kill me? Harog na harog. Hageni na harog. Please get rid of me. If I found favor in your eyes, and I shan't see my own downfall. I won't see my battles. So what does God say? He says, no. Moses, I got a better way. Let me help you. Let us now gather me 70 people. And these 70 people, they're going to get some of your prophecy. It's going to spill over. By the way, the rabbis say it's like a candle being lit from other candles. The original candle doesn't lose its light. It just lights 70 more candles. All right? I'm not going to take anything away from you, but you got to spill over. You got a lot. And now I'm going to pass some of your prophetic energy onto these 70 elders, and I'm going to come down and I'm going to speak to them, and I'm going to put your energy on them, and they're going to help you carry this nation. You won't do it alone. There's a famous rabbi, the Bala Turin, who is the original concordancia, right? He's the original concordance. He gathers all the various places in the Bible, and he says, gather me 70 people. This is related to the 70 souls that came down to Egypt, the original 70 souls. And then he says, and those original 70 souls are related to the 70 nations, okay, as we said before. And he goes, and those 70 nations and those 70 souls are related to the 70 names of God.
Wow.
You guys heard about the Eskimos. They have like 70 names for snow. So the Bible's got 70 names of God. And he lists them. He lists them, 70 names of God. And finally says, and that's of course related to the 70 names of Jerusalem. The Jewish people have 70 names for Yerushalayim. 70 names for Jerusalem. Wow. So we are, ladies and gentlemen, we see that, Moses, the epitome of humility, he may have not wanted to serve God originally. He didn't want to get into the mess, but he did. God almost punished him. He almost lost his own firstborn son because we've got to feel the pain, and he had to feel the pain. So Zipporah, Zephra, a great heroine, saved the son. And then later on, we meet Moses again carrying these people. That very fear of his that I won't be able to carry them, still God says, I will share your prophetic energy, and that prophetic energy is really coming down through the 70 names of God. Oh, one time, just a quick story. One time, I was in Bethel, and I told I was talking about the various names of God, so a child says to me, he was a homeschool kid, American homeschool kid. He says to me, what do you mean, names of God? Why does God have many names? Good question, right? Kids ask the best questions, right? Why does God have many names? I said to him like this, God put an idea in my head, I'll never forget it, because it was like a shot into my brain. I said to him, imagine a businessman, very powerful businessman, and he's got many different email accounts, one just for the family, one just for this business, one just for this business. That's what God has, this is different names. All the email accounts come to the same man, right? Come to the same God. He's got different ways of dealing with it through different categories. And all of us have a different perspective that we bring to the story. Every one of the Sanhedrin that was supposed to sit in this very place in a table, not unlike this one, is supposed to speak 70 of them, is supposed to speak 70 languages so that they connect with every Jew and every person in the world. And I think that today it's really that intensity that I was talking about is that all those 70 lasers are all pointing towards that God that we look to. And we say also that in the future, all the righteous people will sit around the table like this and gaze at God because of the 70 different facets that there is, that everybody brings to the world. So may we really merit to be here together in this.
Thank you.
I just want to point out that we had 70 from the nations here today. That's right. That's exactly it. That's exactly right. God bless you, Rabbi Yehuda Glick. May you be so efficient and a real Sanhedrin. I'll give you one of the 70. You're ready,
I really want to
almost
connect, as I said, with you know, when the prophet, you're familiar with the book of Isaiah chapter 2, speaking about all the nations coming to Israel, but the same prophecy appears in the book of Micha, the prophet, and he there concludes with a beautiful sentence which says, all the peoples walk each in the names of its gods, we will walk in the name of Hashem, our God, forever and ever, meaning that when all the nations will come here, each will call God in their names, and will there have their divine name to God, different 70 names of God. Thank you so much, as always, Isha, you're always heart to you.